Security and Information Systems Information Analysis Center, CSIAC. Today's presentation is entitled Using Unified Code Count, UCC, for Data Collection. My name is Steve Warzala. I am the CSIAC Outreach Manager. A couple of administrative notes before we begin today. First, all phones have been muted except for the presenters. Second, questions may be asked at any time during the presentation by utilizing the chat function. Time permitting, your questions will be answered at the end of the presentation. I'd also like to take a moment to acknowledge and thank our sponsor, the Defense Technical Information Center, DTIC. The funding that DTIC provides enables the CSIAC to conduct these webinars. I'd like to introduce our presenters for today's webinar. For the past 5 years, Anandi Hira has been a member of the team at the USC Center for Systems and Software Engineering, CSSE, and that is responsible for the development of UCC. She's been collecting and analyzing the development process data in order to improve both the processes as well as the quality of the product itself. Anandi is currently a PhD candidate at USC, and her advisor is Dr. Barry Boehm. Her research interests lie in the areas of cost estimation and process improvement. Anandi has also joined the effort within the CSSE to develop COCOMO 3, which is the constructive cost model. Joining Anandi today is Marilyn Spurka. She's been a software engineer at Hughes Aircraft, Raytheon, and the Aerospace Corporation. While at the Aerospace Corp, she served as the project manager in the development and implementation of UCC. Since retiring, Marilyn has continued as a volunteer, assistant instructor, and a technical consultant. I'm going to turn the presentation over to the folks at USC, and we actually have Dr. Barry Boehm joining us today, so I'm going to throw it over to him and let him make a few comments before Anandi begins a presentation. So, Dr. Boehm.
Okay, thanks, Steve. Hello, I'm Barry Boehm, the director of the USC Center for Systems and Software Engineering. We have been evolving the UCC system for about 10 years, and increasingly every year adding to the number of languages that we count, the number of things that we count, and the like. I would like to acknowledge the support and collaboration that we've gotten as we do this. The original version was done by Northrop Grumman, and we agreed to carry it on when they found that it was easier for a university to do this than a company. We'd like to acknowledge the sponsors who have been Aerospace and the National Reconnaissance Office and CSIAC. I think you'll find that UCC does a lot of useful things besides just counting number of statements. So I will pass it on to Anandi, who will elaborate and give you the presentation along with Marilyn.
Thank you, Dr. Barry Boehm. Hello and welcome, everyone. I want to thank you for making the time to join this webinar, and I hope that it will provide you with some useful information about Unified Code Count, or UCC for short. First, I'll go over some general information about UCC, and then we'll do a quick demo of the GUI and command line interfaces, just to make sure everyone is familiar with how it works and also learns about how easy it is to use. Finally, we'll end with some ideas and examples of how UCC can and has been used for data collection and analyses. I know a lot of people do use it for data collection analyses, and though I don't have their examples, I am gathering my own examples from research that I've done and from the work that I've been doing in gathering the data from UCC development in order to improve its processes as much as I can. So let's get started. What is UCC? It's a tool that counts lines of code. Some of the metrics that UCC returns is logical source lines of code, or SLOC, keywords, cyclomatic complexity, and differencing results. And UCC will also report duplicate source files. It currently supports about 30 programming languages, and the development team is constantly working on adding support for more programming languages, as well as other useful features and code-based metrics. We don't currently support fourth-generation languages, but are willing to and are able to, provided that there is sufficient documentation available. UCC is programmed in ANSI C++, which means that it is cross-platform and should compile with any C++ compiler or IDE. The ones that we officially support and test are Microsoft Visual Studio, MinGW, G++, and Eclipse. The GUI interface needs to be set up and compiled in Qt, which is a free cross-platform IDE. However, using the GUI is optional. Users may contact UCC via the website and or email to ask questions. And at the beginning of the demo, I will give you a quick introduction of the website itself. And like I said, you are welcome to contact the development team in order to report bugs or request for new features. We appreciate getting feedback and try to resolve the issues and add new functionality as quickly as time permits. UCC is open source, and the slide that's currently being shown only represents a small number of the organizations that use UCC currently. Many of the users have also contributed code changes, which we incorporate into our releases if it fits the UCC requirements. So that concludes the general information, and now we'll start the quick demo. Okay, so what you should see here is the UCC website. In order to get the UCC package, you will need to create an account here, which you can do from the Member tab. After you create an account, you will be given affiliates access if your organization is an affiliate of the USC Center of Software and Systems Engineering. If not, you're still able to get UCC. You'll just have to get the second most recent version that is available. All the downloads are available on the release tab. And since I'm an administrator, I have access to all the releases, but the one that would be available to most is the 2013-04 version. So I'm going to go ahead and download it here. And unzip it. Okay, so we see here it's in my downloads. So within the UCC package, you will see a directory with all of the counting rules. This will explain the counting rules for each of the different languages that we support. It also has a specific documentation for the cyclomatic complexity results. That's included in the 2014 version, however. We have the release notes, which will go over the changes that have been most recently made since the last version. And of course, the user's manual, which will give you guidance on how to use UCC. So I'm going to go ahead and open the user's manual and go to the section where I need to compile and set up UCC. And since I have a Mac and have G++ as a compiler, this is the command that I will need to use in order to compile UCC. So in my terminal, I'll go to my downloads and go to the package that I just downloaded here. Let's see, 2013-04. All right, and now I'll run the command as it states in the user's manual. All All right, so this will take a while it downloads. In the meanwhile, what I'll do is I'll open Qt. And actually, since the 2013 version doesn't have the GUI yet, I'll go ahead and also download the 2014 version. Okay, so within Qt, I'll go to Open Project, go to where the code is installed, and open the gucc.profile. Okay, it's a desktop. And after it does its initial setting up, I'll hit this green play looking button in order to compile and run it. It should just take a few minutes. Let's see how the command line. Okay, the command line's done. So let's do that first. All right, so you'll see that an executable and the GUI is done at the same time. So here we'll see that all the options that are available through command switches on the command line version are available here as checkboxes in the GUI version. So you can run on specific files. So let's say add file. And let me go ahead and count, let's say, the 2014 code. I'll just pick a couple of files here. And just using all the default options, I can click Start. Oh, oops. Sorry.
Anandi?
Yes.
I don't mean to interrupt, but we're getting a little bit of feedback. Or it sounds like something's blowing on the microphone.
Okay, sorry about
that. Much better. Much better. Thank you.
Okay, so let me actually open a more recent project here. And the reason is because we've made some recent changes and fixed a lot of code here. So let me just start all over because. There we go. Open project. All right, there we go. So let me go ahead and count some files. Just pick a few random files here. And you'll see that the output comes up in a separate window. All the output files that are returned by UCC are available through this dropdown, so you're able to see either one. And the output files are saved wherever the default location is set to. So in my case right now, the default is where I last set it, and I can change this. So let's say I want to put it in a report folder here, and then I run it again. And if I look here, within the report, I'll see the same output files that is available through the GUI in this window. And likewise, all the other functionalities available. So if I want to do differencing, we'll see two sets of side-by-side windows in order to choose files. So I picked this out of 2014. Let me choose a different baseline here. We'll do the 2013. All right, and the report results are here. So the other window we saw open, it should open the differencing results. We have side by side, it's a new feature. But since this is the 2014 version, that will be added in the 2015 version. So all the different output files are available through this dropdown. Okay, so now let's go to the command line version. So as I had started saying, we'll see that an executable is created that which I can run. And let's just say I want to run all of the files in the source folder. So we'll just do source star. Oh, did I do this wrong? Let's see. Okay. All right, let's see what happened. I must be putting in the location wrong. So let me just give it the full path. And there we go. Okay, there we go. And you'll see that the output files are created within the folder with which I'm in currently. And again, you can specify the output directory using the outdir switch. So if I just do outdir, and now the reports will be in here in the report directory because that's where I specified for it to go to. And like I said, you can do differencing. The differencing switch is dash D. And all the different functionalities are available through the switches. And if you ever are confused and are not sure, you can always refer to the user's manual. We have specific instructions on each of the different command switches and how they're used, what the input specifications are expected, et cetera, et cetera. And there's also a help available through the command line that you're available to use. All right, so that's for the quick demo. Let's go back to the slides and we'll talk about the analyses and data collection you can do. Okay, so here I have some examples of some scripts. So data collection is really important for software teams and organizations, of course, because it helps developer update cost models or create a catalog of similar projects. We also use it in order to improve processes and the like. And UCC, with its command line interface, allows for you to create some simple scripts in order to make the data collection process a little bit more time effective. So here are some examples of some easy loops that I've created. And what it does is it goes through a directory in order to do counting for the first little script here. And the second one will run differencing compared to the baseline. So since we do projects every semester, I have the baseline with the semester name. So you'll notice here, 2010, 3 fall. And then each project that's been completed that semester will follow the same concept same naming convention with a final underscore with the project name. And so this script will allow for that to be compared to the baseline in order to get how much code was modified during each of the semester projects. Of course, the example here I have is in Bash, since I have a Mac computer, but you can easily make similar scripts in DOS for Windows machines. Someone who's technically inclined or familiar with scripting can easily create scripts with predefined directory naming structures and can distribute the script to to everyone or to the team or to an organization so that everyone can kind of help in the data collection process. So it's very helpful to have a command line version in order for scripting and things like this. Also, of course, the GUI makes it easy for those who are not familiar or not comfortable doing command line commands, and that will make it more visual and easy to use, of course. So on the next slide, this is just an example of how I have organized the directory structures for my own purpose in order to make the scripting process easy. So on the left side is the directory structure of the code from each of the projects, and on the right side are the results. So on the left side, it's chronologically organized, but on the right side, I have it organized by project. So that's why I moved the project name to the beginning, and then the fall or the semester for the project is towards the end. So quick and classic analysis is to compare SLOC to effort. On this slide here, I'm comparing the UCC development SLOC to the effort. The light blue line, the very topmost light blue line, is the UCC development curve. And the other two lines are the Kokomo curves. So the dark blue that's towards the bottom there is the Kokomo curve with all of the attributes set to nominal or average. I then modified a lot of the factors, which are listed in the red box over to the right side, that more closely resemble the UCC's development environment, and that resulted in the green curve. So this shows me that the SLOC to effort curve is the same shape as the Kokomo cost model curve, but there may be some factors leading to the extra effort required in the UCC development. One thing is that the lowest personnel continuity rating available in Kokomo is set to about 10% per year, whereas the UCC development team experiences a 10% personnel continuity over 4 months. So this could very well result in the change or the difference in the curve. And of course, this will help managers or even developers look into whether their processes need to be improved, or maybe there are other factors affecting the projects that they may be either overlooking or are completely unaware of. So I know that I've used this in order to take a closer look into the process of the UCC development. And of course, like I said, personnel continuity is definitely an issue that we face that causes a huge productivity decline. The next slide shows an example of an analysis we did on an open source project. And here we're looking at how much of the code was modified for each of the versions. So down on the bottom, it just displays the different version numbers. And the red that's towards the bottom is the percent of new code. The yellow that's towards the middle of each of these curves is the percent deleted code. And the top gray, kind of gray-blue, is the percent of code that's been modified. So this can help give teams visibility about what kinds of code changes have occurred and make test processes accordingly. So if there's a lot of new code, we'll need to create more tests to test those code pieces. If there's a lot of deleted or modified code, then we'll need to make sure that we do some good regression testing to make sure that all the functions work as expected, and whatever bugs or maybe functionality that needs to be changed is changed as expected as well. This can also help one in looking at how the different, like how the percent new, deleted, or modified actually affects the effort. And someone could create a calibration of the equivalent source lines of code with respect to or compared to new code. And that could be different for each individual. And I'm noticing here that some people want me to clarify some of the acronyms I'm using. So at the very beginning, I did say SLOC is for source lines of code. Let's see, UCC is for unified code count. COCOMO is the constructive cost model that's been developed by Dr. Bain and USC. And let's see, are there any other acronyms that I have been using that I didn't previously define? Okay, if you do have questions about it, please do feel free to ask. Okay, so continuing with the next set of analyses. This is another research project that I did in order to compare the productivity with a number of defects and the total cyclomatic complexity and average cyclomatic complexity. And the observation that we saw is that as the productivity declined, more or less the number of defects increased, as well as the cyclomatic complexity. And there have been many research papers done on there being a direct correlation between cyclomatic complexity and defects. And we saw in this open source project that that was definitely the case. We noticed this in the open source project as well. So this kind of analysis helps us see what is the cyclomatic complexity of your code. You know, is that causing a lot of defects? It could encourage teams in order to look at their code and reduce the complexity of it and try to make it more clear and easy to understand. A study by HP actually had concluded that reducing the cyclomatic complexity of their modules had eventually resulted in fewer and fewer defects over time. And I see that someone's asking how productivity here is being measured. So the productivity here is being measured as the total equivalent source lines of code divided by the effort. Okay, so that concludes all of the analyses and the essential webinar here. So let's open it up to any questions that anyone may have.
Okay, so Anandi, on your last slide, there was a question about the cyclomatic complexity. Are there maps? Asking if there are maps for that, so you know they can look into that.
It's something that I have actually recently considered. I just recently read a book about cyclomatic complexity and how people have used it. And learned that, you know, the mapping, of course, will definitely help. So it's something that we will look into doing. As of right now, UCC will only provide you the final numbers. And it breaks it down into files and functions. So you can know, you'll be able to tell which functions have higher cyclomatic complexity and or files, depending on what level of granularity you're looking for. But currently, we don't have maps. I do believe there are other software available, but it's something that we are looking into providing within UCC so that everyone can look at the results just from one software versus having to use several.
Okay, and staying on kind of the same topic, one of our attendees has a question. If you could kind of go into a little bit more detail, looking at the link between the cyclomatic complexity and the defect generation. Can you discuss that a little bit?
Well, in the research that we've done, and this was on this specific example, is just from one of the open source projects. So you can see here that we did see that the defects increase, and as did the average cyclomatic complexity and the total cyclomatic complexity. And the idea here is that as cyclomatic complexity increases, the code becomes more and more difficult to understand. So cyclomatic complexity counts the number of decision points that there are in your function or in your file. And the more decision points you have, the more, I guess, back and forth, if you will, that you have. So if you were to imagine a map, it would be having like a straight line of logical sequence versus having, you know, lines going from this function to another function, then you're coming back or you're going calling a different function. So the more you have, the more decision points you have, the more difficult it is to explain or to understand the flow of the code. So that's why we see that there's an increase in defects as cyclomatic complexity increases. There's more code to change, there's more to understand, and it also reduces the learning curve of understanding code.
Okay, thank you. So one of our attendees says that they've measured staff competency and found that productivity and complexity improves as the competency goes up. And they're asking if is this congruent with your results? Have you found the same thing in your studies?
So just to confirm, by improved complexity, that means that the cyclomatic complexity reduced or the complexity reduced, whichever metric you may be using.
So that question came from Lonnie Franks. Yes, reduced MCC.
Okay, so yes, I would expect for that to definitely happen. With the research that I've done, we did it on open source projects, so we don't have access to the personnel information. We don't know exactly who's been working on the projects and how long they've been on the project or what their competency is. But something I've noticed within UCC is that more and more recently, the productivity has been increasing, although we have been improving our processes. So it could be either from the competency and or from the processes. But I have been noticing that the productivity has been increasing. I also tried to do an analysis on the cyclomatic complexity and efforts and number of bugs for the UCC development projects. And I noticed that the cyclomatic complexity and effort didn't have a strong correlation. So I can't say anything conclusive about it. I think in UCC, we have a lot of factors going into the development. So there's a lot of normalization that I would need to do before giving any concrete results. But it does make sense that as the competency increases, that the complexity would decrease. Because, you know, just logically speaking, as the personnel is more familiar with the code, they are able to fix it or make it more simpler versus someone who's less familiar, you know, they could be modifying code in order to make patches that fulfill the requirements but might not necessarily reduce the complexity.
Okay, yeah, intuitively it would seem that as these skills increase, you would see improvements. So. So now let's see, there is another question on productivity. What equation was used for determining the equivalent lines of code in your productivity measure?
So what we used is the equation that's specified by the Kokomo 2. So in there, it does have a factor of software understanding and familiarity. And though we did not know necessarily what that was for the open source projects, we just set it to average. And what it does, it kind of does a proportional, and let me actually go to this slide. It does a proportional of the different types of codes, the modified and the deleted and the new. And the new, of course, is new, so that has its own proportion. One thing we did do with this graph, though, from the differential analysis, is we did try to see if we change the proportions, you know, would it change the analysis? And we noticed that it did not change the analysis very much at all. It seemed that for the most part, the percentage of modified, deleted, and new was more or less the same when you take the average over the versions. So there was very little change. And even on this slide, you can see that for the most part, most code is new. You could say like about 40 to 50%. Then we have about 20 to 30 that's modified, and then 10 to 20 that's deleted. And there are only a few versions here where all of the code is modified. So versions 5, 12, and 14, you see that they only have modified code. And those are definitely not the norm.
And so one of our attendees has a question about unchanged code. So you don't have a category for that. So is that something?
That's something we didn't analyze for this particularly, because we were trying to separate the amount of code that was changed, the amount of work that went into having to change, because we were looking at how productivity was affected by the amount of work that was being done on changing code. So we didn't look into the unmodified, but I did notice while doing it that there was a direct correlation between the number of new code to modified. So as the new code had increased, there was a higher unmodified percentage as well.
Okay. That was an interesting question. You were looking primarily at the change. So that answers that. Okay. Let's see. The productivity slide shows a linear relation with size. Can you comment on this? This individual says they're seeing some recent analysis suggesting increasing productivity as ELOC size increases.
Okay, so I'm assuming that this is the slide you're talking about, slide 12.
Increases Kokomo and UCC.
Okay. So it's actually a power function. It's not necessarily linear. When I do a linear, it would go across more diagonally, if you will. So it's actually a power function. It does look more linear, though. I mean, if you look at the line, it looks very linear, of course. Yes, that is true. But as the factors, as the Kokomo parameters are changed, if the more projects I have, so if I went up a little bit more, you would notice that this curve does slightly curve up, resembling the power function. You'll notice here that the range that I have is very small, so that's why it looks more linear. So we're not getting to the point where it starts to curve up and you're able to clearly see it, but it is a power function, it's not a linear.
Okay, and we have a question about, can you use the UCC output like a function point to benchmark teams?
Like a function point, as in the metric function point that we usually use as input to estimate? Or do you just mean as a benchmark? Yeah, okay. That is something that we're actually going to start recently looking into, is calculating the function points in order to see how that relates to the effort and to better scope the projects. So that's something that we're looking into. We haven't done that yet, but you know, maybe next time around, that's something I'll be able to report on.
Okay, and we have a question about what algorithm was used to actually detect the differences.
So the differences comes from UCC, and what UCC does is it compares the logical lines of code, so logical SLOC, to the other ones in the different baselines, and it compares how much of the characters are different. You can set a threshold. The default is 60%. So if it's more than 60% different, then it's considered a deleted and added line. Whereas if it's less than 60%, then it's considered a modified line. So it's logical SLOC compared to logical SLOC, and then the number of characters that are different.
Okay, let's see. I think there was a question about can you count comments? I believe you can, but I'll let you answer for sure.
Okay. UCC does return comments. Let me go back to my screen real quick, my desktop, and see if I can show it to you real quick. Let's see, did it have the output? Okay, maybe I'll have to get it from the report. Okay, so it gives you the total lines, the number of blank lines. It gives you the number of comments, whole and embedded, compiler directives, data declarations, executable instructions, logical and physical SLOC. And it also gives you keywords. This is the C++, but if you look at the CSV files, usually towards the bottom, it gives you a list of all the different keywords and then the numbers of keywords that were found as well.
Okay, and someone wants to know, how does it count two logical lines of code with no delta? What bucket does that fall into?
I'm sorry, can you repeat that one more time? How it counts two logical lines with no delta? So as in if those two are the same in two different baselines?
Let's see, same as the unmodified question, almost.
So in the differencing results, it will count as an unmodified line, as an unmodified logical SLOC. And as far as the actual counting, so when you do the differencing, it also will return counting results on each of the baselines, and it will count each of them separately. But as far as the differential, if the logical SLOC are exactly the same, it will count as unmodified. Does that answer your question?
And we have another question about how does it count unmodified code on the SLOC differential analysis slide?
Okay, so this slide here. So this one doesn't show the unmodified. I just showed the modified, deleted, and new. Let me share my desktop again. Okay, so we did a differencing here, and here's the differencing results. So you'll notice here what it does is it tells you the number of new lines, the number of deleted lines, the number of modified lines, and the number of unmodified lines. In my analysis, we just looked at the first three. We were looking at the new lines, deleted lines, and modified lines. But in the UCC differencing results, it will give you all four. It will tell you how many new lines, how many deleted, modified, unmodified. And since we're talking about talking about the differencing. So let me show you another analysis I started doing with UCC. Let's see, where is it? Okay, so I counted, or I considered the differencing results for the new language counters that we worked on, and I compared it to C++ and Java. So the top four or five or six rows here, I guess eight, is for C++, and then this middle one here is for Java. So I compared for all the different threshold. So I just did it in intervals of 10. So from 0 to 10, all the way up to 100. And what I noticed for the most part here is the number of unmodified does not change whatever, no matter what the threshold is. So it's 1 here, it's 1 here, it's going to be 1 for 70 and for 80, etc. All the rest, though, will change depending on what the threshold is. And the threshold is just to define when do we count a line added and deleted, so deleted from the first baseline, added in the other one, or just modified. So I hope this helps a little bit clarify what the added, deleted, modified, and unmodified means.
Okay, thank you for going into that explanation, Anandi. Appreciate that. There's a question about can you show, you know, how an example of how this can be used to estimate costs. I don't know if now UCC may be more of an input to Kokomo, but I guess if you can take a stab at that question.
So what can happen to code quality and execution speed if management places an extreme focus on complexity? I have not done research on this. Let's see. If you focus on complexity, it seems that the overall quality of your code, and by quality, I would mean its maintainability, so how easy it is to maintain and to understand, will improve, definitely. The execution speed, I think, would depend. It's possible that that would also decrease or will be better because it's possible that by reducing the cyclomatic complexity of your code, you're making it more efficient and more smooth, but it might not have an effect on it at all. So that would be something worth looking into as a research project or as a research question, but something I don't have an objective answer for.
Okay, thank you. Okay, and then we have a question about the who can access this? Is it downloadable? Can anyone sign up? You know, just go to your site and download it, or do you have to be a member? What, you know, are there restrictions to gain access to the UCC tool?
Right. So it is available to everyone. It is open source. Here, let me share my desktop one more time. I may as well keep it here. So let me just go to the UCC website really quick. So if you go to member and you can sign up to be a member, and if you're an affiliate, what happens is in the releases, you'll have access to the most recent version, and that's for the first year. If you're not an affiliate, you still have access to UCC. You'll just have access to the second most recent and all the other archives as well. So the affiliates will have access to all the versions, including the most recent. the non-affiliates will have access to the second most version, the second most recent version. And that will be, so whatever version comes out, let's say if I put out a version this August, then next August they will have access to that version. But other than that, the creating an account here and downloading UCC, it's all free. It's available to everyone. And while we're here, I just wanted to point out, so you can find the UCC contact information on the homepage here. So this little box called contact, and here is the email address. And if you go to the forum, oh, well, it looks like it's currently upgrading. The website is right now. It does that automatically every once in a while. And let me go ahead and do this so you can take a quick look at it. But other than that, when you go to the forum, there are several threads or topics that are available under which you can create a topic. So there's one for requesting upgrades or features. There's one for bug reports. There's one for general questions that you may have as far as how to use UCC, how to interpret its results, any other question that you might have, you can put in there. And apparently this is going to take some time, so we won't worry about that. But yes, it's available to everyone.
And there was a question about, do you have an idea of how many folks in the DoD, Air Force, might be utilizing the UCC tool? Do you have any figures, estimates on that?
I don't have the exact numbers. One of the clients I work very closely with from NRO is in charge of kind of making it a standard. And I know that she talks to me about it several times, but I don't have access to the details of that. That's not something that USC manages or overlooks, if you will. But I know that there are a lot of organizations in the DoD that are being encouraged to use it as a standard.
Okay, thanks for the feedback on that question. Well, let's see. Did I try to go through the list? I hope I hit everybody's questions. If there's something I missed, if folks want to try and shoot an update. Otherwise, if we hit all the questions, thank you, Anandi. We had a lot of a lot of feedback, a lot of interest out there. So thank you for fielding those questions. You did a very, very nice job going into more detail and explaining and clarifying. So appreciate that very much. And like to thank everyone for signing in and attending today. Glad to have you aboard. I hope you found it informative and interesting. So if there's anything else you'd like to say, Anandi, before we sign off?
I just want to thank everyone again for making the time to join this webinar. And I really do hope I was able to give you a brief introduction to UCC and answer any questions you have, and hopefully also give you examples of how you can use it for data collection and analyses. Thank you.
Okay. Well, thanks again, Anandi. Appreciate it very much. Dr. Baim, thank you for your intro. And once again, to all our attendees, thank you. And everyone, have a great day.